so happy to be at church. I love church. Let me share some stories with you. Thursday, I get a phone call late at night. And so it's a friend of mine. I've been friends with him for 20 years. It's the same friend, if you know the story, that would take me at my dorm room. It was my freshman year of college. And he took me in my dorm room and he said, "Do you believe in God?" And I said, "Yeah, what's this about?" And then before you know it, they were hammering me. "Do you believe in God? Like, do you really believe in God?" I'm like, "Yeah, I believe in God. What's your deal?" They go, "But do you think it's maybe just a bunch of made-up stories and a book that maybe someone just conjured up a few hundred years ago and then passed it on as a really old book?" And I was like, "Yeah, I believe in God. What is your deal?" And then they just kept on and kept on. So I get a phone call. 20 years I've been good friends, real good friends, you know. So 20 years, there's Thursday night, I get a phone call. And he said, "Hey, I have something to tell you." I said, "What?" He said, "I accepted Jesus tonight in my life." And I said, "No, you didn't." And I started laughing. I was like, "You're a liar." And so he said, "No, I really did." He had been going through some stuff, right, in his life. And so he had called me and he said, "Man, some stuff's really going on." And I told him, I said, "Hey, listen, I've got someone I want you to talk to. He's a good friend of mine. He's a pastor in that particular state that he lives in." And I said, "Hey," I said, "would you be willing to meet with him?" He said, "Yeah." So I called him, my friend, and said, "Hey, listen, this is my friend for 20 years. He needs Jesus. Like introduce Jesus to him." And so he said, "All right." So on the phone, my friend calls me with my other friend beside him in a speakerphone. And when I said, "No, you didn't," my other friend said, "He better. I just talked to him about Jesus for 4 hours. And I said, "I've been talking to him about Jesus for 20 years. I was like, "What are you talking about?" So it was just a fun time, you know, talking back and forth. And so he said, "No, I really did. I really accepted Jesus in my life." So then, for the past few days, I've been trying to, like, think of all of this, you know, like, really, like, measure it. Because that's what men do. We want to measure stuff. We want to try to figure out the wisdom behind it all. And so me and Steve, our sound guy, we went to go do something yesterday, and I was talking to him about it. And I said, "You know," I said, we started talking real deep theology stuff. And I ended up looking like Job's friend. If you know the book of Job, I look like his friend that obviously gets cursed at the end of the book. But I was like, "Why? You know, why God? Why God? Is it the mechanics of the sin? You know, how is it that my friend gets saved after 20 years? Like, I'm trying to, like, think of all of this stuff." And so I dropped Steve back off at his house, and I'm driving home, and I hear the still small voice. And Jesus said, "I saved your friend because I love him." I'm sorry. I cry a lot, I know. Everyone's like, "That's all Josh ever does is cry." I know, I cry a lot, because I think it's just that God's love is so good and he's so faithful, even though when we're not faithful, you know. And so I hear Jesus say, and I texted Steve immediately, and I was like, "Steve, it wasn't the mechanics of sin. It wasn't the thought of how bad it was, that's why he came to know who Jesus was. He came to know Jesus because he recognized how much Jesus loves him. And that's what it's all about." And so we get really caught up in trying to figure it all out, and we can't figure it out. It's simply put, Jesus loves us. That's it. And so I get into today's Father's Day message of future hope, because a lot of us who have children, who have sons and daughters, we want them to be something, right? We want them to have a better future than we have. And so a lot of times the world presents itself as bleak. You know, a pastor that my wife listens to often, and I do as well, and he's gone and in heaven now, but Brother Hagin says, "You know, when I see the world, all I see is I see healing. Everywhere I look, I see healing." You know, that's not positive speaking. That's not the case. You know, what happened here in Orlando this past week was very tragic, and I don't believe that any one of us in this room would ever wish that upon anyone. It is awful. It is beyond comprehensible at times, for sure. And so a lot of us can look at this and we hear all of the news media and we get caught up in the bleakness and the tragedy of it all. But you know what? We as Christians see the healing. We see the healing. We see the faith. We see the greatness of what God can do. And so a lot of times we got to put on our faith goggles. We got to put on what the Word of God says. And we got to say, you know what? This is what the Word of God says. This is not the end result. This is not the have to be. You know what? God loves us. Simply put, He loves us. And so we can see the fertile soil of we get a chance to put seed in the ground. My friend on the phone, he said, Josh, I'm so sorry that you weren't the one that could talk me into to the understanding of who Jesus is. He said, talk me into. So I was like, are you really saved? I was like, did my friend twist your arm? Like, how did it work? And I said, that's not how it works, man. I said, it's not like I get an extra crown or an extra jewel on my crown because I talked you to about Jesus. I said, I sowed a seed 20 years ago, Jordan, and I'm getting the victory myself right now that my friend who got to show and share Jesus with you. I said, I get to do this. You know, I get to be a part of it just as much as he gets to be a part of it. But it's not a matter of I get a reward because of it. That's not the case either. I'm just so excited that you know who Jesus is in your life. That's it. So oftentimes, you know, as bleak as things look, we have the opportunity to look at it through God's eyes and say there is healing. There is a purpose. So no matter how small the seed it is, guess what? It's still there. My daughter, this past week, she was out on the deck. We were at the beach, and so she looked up, and she saw the moon, and she pointed to the moon and looked at my mom, her mama, and said, Mama, I want to go there. That's exactly how she put it. And she goes, you do? And so then Papa chimes in, because Papa's obviously everything's good with Papa. Papa looked at her and goes, and you will. So I look at Papa going, what is wrong with you? Like, hold on, right? Because immediately in my head, I start thinking about it. All the schooling, all the physical fitness side of it all. There's going to be a lot of barriers and a lot of walls. Not everyone who just says, I want to be an astronaut or I want to go to the moon gets to go. There's actually a long process to this. So don't you just be giving her this false hope, right? So I look at all of the heaviness. So sometimes we can get into the bleakness of it and get our eyes caught on the things that are, it's actually not what God wants. God wants us to look at the good stuff. What if God told her in that moment, even at 3 years old, told her, hey, you're going to be an astronaut someday, right? So she has an opportunity to seize that and say, God, what is it? God, what is it that you want me to do and how am I going to accomplish this? Too often we look at the world, we look at the things around us and we think it's too hard, too complicated. In Lamentations, which is an awesome book, Lamentations. It was written by Jeremiah. In Lamentations chapter 3, verse 17, it says, I have been deprived of peace. I have forgotten what prosperity is. So I say, my splendor is gone, and all that I had hoped from the Lord. I remember my affliction and my wandering and the bitterness and the gall. I remember them, and my soul was downcast within them. You know, for every distortion that you have about God, there is a correspondence consequence. For every distortion that you have, that distortion of you think you know who God is, but you really don't. You try to understand God, but you really don't because you know that His ways are higher than our ways. But here in this distortion, some of our distortion that we may have is that we think, man, I've sinned a lot. I'm a really bad person. I just did something really bad. So therefore, God doesn't love me anymore. He wants nothing to do with me. So therefore, the consequence in my head is I become distant from God. I run from Him because I'm ashamed. It's just like Adam in the Garden of Eden, right? The minute he felt the sin, he goes and hides. And so God fervently goes out and is yelling for Adam. Adam, where are you? Adam, where are you? He says, I'm hiding. I'm over here. He says, why are you hiding? Because I've sinned. God knew that he sinned. God's no dummy, right? We know this. God knew what happened. But he still sought after Adam. Adam, where are you? And so for us, we tend to run because of the distortion that we have in our head of who God is. The consequences, the result is actually very corruptive. But we've got to wake up from these distortions and know who God is. So in those moments of times of trial and tribulation, we wake up and you go, you know what? We got to run towards God. We got to be with him. He wants to be with us. His love is unfailing and it's always faithful. And so in Lamentations, Jeremiah points out this moment that I've forgotten what prosperity is. It's become so desolate and so hard and so difficult. But yet in verse 21, he says, yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. I love what he says. Yet this I call to mind. I call to mind. I remember God's unfailing love. I know who he is. I call to mind. When we see things, we start picturing and we start going down this path where we make bug out bags and we put a bunker in our backyard and we buy a lot of AR-15s. Hey, don't get me wrong. I'm an NRA type of guy. Don't get me wrong. I've got guns myself, but I'm going down the path. And you guys know the path I'm going down. So don't sit here and get all mad at Pastor Josh and think he's a jerk right now. I'm not a jerk. I'm just getting you out of the fear, okay, and getting you into the eyes of God and say, God is faithful and God is ever-present and his love can conquer everything. And so just remember, I have a gun. Don't get me wrong. I'm going to go down a rabbit trail real quick. I have a gun. I have a good old cowboy rifle and I have a cowboy hat to go with it. I'm not kidding. It's not a joke. It's a Stetson. It's pretty sweet. It's black, too. I made sure it was black. It's nice. It's the straight one. It looks like, you know, like, no, not like Will Smith. I'm so way cooler than Will Smith. Come on. No, everyone stop. Let me tell you the cowboy that I am. You don't need to tell me. Gosh, Doc Holliday. Back off. See? Way cooler. From the Tombstone movie, that one, right? Really cool. Okay, anyway. But here's the thing, guys. We get down in this whole fear trail, this trail of going down, but we forget what God's word says. What did he tell Peter? You live by the sword, you die by the sword. Peter's quick to draw, right? A lot of times we're quick to draw on what the world tells us to do, right? We're quick. Let's just do this. Let's mount up, right? But then we got to look at God's word, and God says what? He says, don't live by the sword. He wants us to live by his word. He wants us to live by what his word says. That's what it's all about. But so in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 21, it says, yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. And in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13, it solidifies this. It says, if we are unfaithful, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny who he is. God is always faithful. In those moments where we feel like we're far from him, guess what? We're not. God brings us in even closer. We just have to choose to follow him. So do not let those dreams, those pursuits of happiness, those moments of trying to do something, and when the world comes at you or when the enemy comes at you, guess what? You don't sit here and just get defeated. You step up and you say, God's got me. I know what God's word told me. I know what he told me to do. I'm obedient to his word. I want to pursue this. God's instructed me to do it. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9, it says, in his heart a man plans his course, but the Lord will what? Determine his steps. So I've determined that God will determine these. I've determined that in my own head. God determines my steps, so he's doing this. He's ordering my steps. So without this crazy theologies that come in, without all that stuff, I block all that stuff out, all these misconceptions of who God is that I've conjured up in my head, trying to figure him out, quite simply again, God loves us. And God's going to protect us. And he is faithful to the end. You know, I love the story of Abraham. Abraham comes to us. We first hear his first worldly name given to him, Abram. And then eventually God changes it to Abraham. So in Abram, in chapter 11, we hear the lineage of Abraham, who his father was, and all that kind of stuff. And then eventually we see in chapter 12, the call of Abraham. So with Abram, God says to him, says, hey, I want you to go do something. I want you to gather all of your goods, all of your people, and your wife, and I want you to go over into Canaan. Now, what's funny about this is, it's not funny, it's funny for us to read it today, but in Genesis chapter 12, verse 10, it says, at that time, a severe famine struck the land of Canaan. Imagine God calls you. You know you hear God's voice, and God says, I want you to go here, and I want you to do this. And then famine strikes. But not just famine, severe famine, like the worst of the worst. It's wild how God works at times, right? It's hard, it's a bad situation, and yet God still, he says, I'll take care of you, in the midst of all of that. And he tells Abram, he says, hey, I'm going to make you a father of a great nation. You're going to have great wealth. I'm going to always bless you. Every step that you take, I will follow you. What did he do? Remember, if you continue to keep reading, you see that Lot, his nephew, started growing large in his wealth as well as being in the camp of Abraham. And so Lot is taken to the side, and Abraham says, hey, you got a lot of stuff going on. I got a lot of stuff going on. I think there's some bickering going on. We don't need that. We're a good family, right? We're a good family. And he takes him on top of this huge hill, and he says, all right, if you go to the right, I'll go to the left. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. I'll let you choose. You know what Lot did? Lot chose wrongly no matter what. If whether he chose left or chose right, he chose wrongly. You know why? Because you got to stay in the blessing of God always. You know what he should have done is got rid of some of the servants that were fighting. Maybe cut some of his losses and give away some of his sheep, right? Instead, he says, okay, I'll go to the right. This looks pretty good over here. It looks really nice. He actually even gave Abraham the worst of the land. The worst. He said, oh, yeah, I'll take this green area over here, Sodom and Gomorrah, right? This looks good. So he leaves the blessing, leaves that covering. You got to stay underneath the covering, right? And so Abraham, he gets into a moment, okay? And Abraham gets in this moment where he gets focused in on the gift and not the gift giver. Because what happens is he sees the wealth, he sees that he's becoming a great wealthy nation. However, he's got no heir to give this to. And so in a vision, we see it in Genesis chapter 15. This was some years later, roughly 10 years later. He says, sometime later, the Lord spoke to Abram in a vision and said to him, do not be afraid, Abram, for I will protect you and your reward will be great. But Abram replied, but due to the fact, God's speaking to him because he's seen Abram upset. He's seen him upset. And so Abram replies, says, oh, sovereign Lord, what good are all your blessings when I don't have a son? Since you've given me no children, Eleazar of Damascus, a servant in my household, will inherit all my wealth. You have given me no descendants of my own, so one of my servants will be my heir. So you know what's sad is that Abraham is not seeing that God is revealing himself over and over and over again, the faithfulness of God. Yet, again, he's losing focus. He's put his focus on the gift, the promise, right? The promise that, hey, you promised me that I will be a great nation, yet I have no heir. And he's questioning God, but yet God's so good, and his love is unfailing. And he responds to him in such a loving manner. And he says it here in Genesis chapter 15, verse 4. It says, then the Lord said to him, know your servant will not be your heir. Oh, it's so good, right? He didn't correct Abraham in an abrasive manner like some of us think that it's going to happen. God's going to put a scarlet A on our chest. Like we go right into like the deep darkest of it all, you know. God's going to scorn me. But we get so focused in on the gift and not the gift giver. God is so good, right? This past week, we were at the beach, and unfortunately my wife was sick the entire week. So I had 4 children on the beach with me. It was miserable. I had to make sure that no one was drowning. And the worst mistake that I've made all week long is I didn't reapply. Only the moms laugh because the dads are like, what's reapply mean? Exactly. You reapply the sunscreen. Look at my son's nose. Poor kid. It's awful looking. But what do? You can only do so much. So I had a cooler, right? I had this cooler. And inside the cooler, I had so much water and so much Cheez-It bags and little crackers and little things. And so before you know it, my children are, they're in a desert. They're in a desert. And we're only like 100 yards away from the place we were renting, right? But we were in the desert, and it was awful. Dad, I'm thirsty. I'm hungry, right? And so I go, guys, here's the water. And they drink the water. And then I'm like, all right, guys, I've got to divide the food up now because you guys have eaten a lot of it. And so I've got to share it. I don't want to share. Like, dude, it's going to be okay. Just share 2 crackers here, 2 crackers there. I don't want to share. Carly looks at me and she goes, I want mommy. You don't get mommy. You mean, I want mommy. Mommy's not here right now. Mommy's is in bed right now. I said, why do you want mommy? Because I want Cheez-Its. That's exactly right. You don't want mommy. You want mommy because daddy won't give you what you want, and you know that mommy will. Mommy is not available right now. See, it's just like us, though. We want what God can give us, but we don't want God. We know that God has the power. We know that God has the ability. But guess what? We get focused in on all the wrong perspectives. And we need to look at what God is, who he is, his faithfulness, that he just loves us. If we become consumed with this, then we wouldn't be worried about the gifts and when they arrive and when they don't arrive. Instead, we look in his faithfulness and we say, that's good enough. I want to be with him. God is so good, right? You know, I find comfort. No matter where I look, there's always birds. Everywhere we go, there's birds, right? We could easily stand up right now. We could walk outside and look up in the air and we would see birds. They're everywhere. I'm sitting on the beach and I'm watching these birds fly across the ocean. It's so beautiful, right? You know, I don't see their homes. I have no idea where they nest. These are big birds. I like to see their nests. I'm curious, you know, these big old pelicans. I see some just dive into the ocean. It's like it's a beautiful sight to watch these birds. And so I find it curious that Jesus uses an example of birds to give us comfort. But I think it's because we see them as a daily reminder of God's faithfulness. And he says it in Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. It says, that is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food and drink or enough clothes to wear. Isn't life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you far more valuable to him than they are? That's what it's all about. We can easily go out and we can see the reminder of the faithfulness of God, that God takes care of the air. He takes care of the animals, and we too can be taken care of. We get so caught up in the gifts. God, please. God, we beg God. God, God, why? But if we just get into the intimacy with God, our future hope is secure. Our future hope is there. No matter, even though we know, as I know my daughter who wants to be an astronaut now, right? I know of the future of some of the difficulties just based upon readings or documentaries that I've watched. I go, oh, this is going to be a tough path. But guess what? If God told her to do it, then it will be taken care of. And so my future hope is secure. My future hope in my children is secure. My future hope in my friend's life is secure. Everyone is secure. When you know who Jesus is in your life is secure. He never leaves you. He never abandons you. His love is not a competition. His love is for everyone. And it's just a matter of us acknowledging the fact that the kingdom of God lives inside of us. A lot of times we look at the kingdom of God as a really far-fetched belief or hard to believe. But you guess what? The kingdom of God lives in all of us. And because the kingdom of God lives inside of us, we can become kingdom-minded. That we see everything through God's eyes. That our future hope is more evident than ever before. Our vision is clear and we're able to see God's truth. And so when you sit here today on Father's Day and you celebrate your dad or you yourself are a father, guess what? If you know who Jesus is, your future is secure. And if, as long as you instruct and teach your children to be raised in the Word of God, then their future is secure as well. Let's pray. God, we thank you for our time with you together. And Lord, we thank you that we as a generation know who we are in Christ. God, that we are exactly who you've called us to be. And Lord, we will not be tossed to and fro. Lord, that we will stand firm in your blessings. God, we thank you for this. With every head bowed and eye closed, I want us to be bold. Many of you in this room, you want to secure. You want the security. You want to know who you are. Your identity rests upon the shoulders of God, really. It's not in your hands. Too often we feel like we've got to work the system in order to secure our identity, but that's not the case. God has your identity and he wants to share it with you. He changed Abram's name into Abraham. He made a promise with him, a covenant, a blood covenant with Abraham that his people would be taken care of. And then Jesus came in and actually fulfilled that promise. And that promise, that blood that shed on the cross, takes care of the promise that was given to Abraham. And so now that all people could come to know who Jesus is. All people would come to have a relationship with God. Not just one generation or not just one group of people, but all people can come to know who they are in God. So I want us all together corporately to pray this prayer together. I want us to say it with boldness and with fervency that God is real and that we repent. And so I want us to do it. I really want us to do it in the manner of knowing God loves us. So with your whole heart, repeat after me, Jesus, I repent. And I know that my sin is washed away because of the blood shed on the cross. And so today, I recognize that you are my Lord and personal Savior. That I am no longer important, but you are. And I love you. And from this day on, I am yours, and you are mine. In Jesus' name, amen. If you were to continue to read the scripture there in Genesis, God, in talking to Abraham in Genesis chapter 15, it says, then the Lord said to him, no, your servant will not be your heir, for you will have a son of your own who will be your heir. Then the Lord took Abram outside and said to him, look up into the sky and count the stars if you can. I like to imagine that Abram steps outside and he looks up and God's there with him. And he says, count the stars if you can. And Abram's like, okay, one, two. God, this is way too hard. And he says, well, count if you can. One, two. I'm getting lost. There's so many stars. I can't count them all. And God replies, I can. Abraham says, but I can't. There's so many, but I can, God says. In those moments in your life when you say, I can't, God can. God sees the fulfillment of the full promise. Even though you may not be able to see it, guess what? He can. In those moments that you've declared today that Jesus Christ is your Lord and personal Savior, and those moments that it seems bleak and it seems hard and it seems desolate, and you're sitting there saying, God, I can't, God can.